Is President Poroshenko afraid to debate his challenger Volodymyr Zelensky? Are Ukraine and Georgia exacerbating tensions in the Black Sea? And did a Russian anchor admit she lies on television? The truth is a prisoner in Russia's gulag of disinformation. But this is Stop Fake, the place where we set the record straight on fakes about Ukraine. I'm Marko Suprun, so get ready for some debunking. Several pro-Kremlin media outlets announced this week that Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko is afraid of debating presidential candidate Volodymyr Zelensky. Gazeta.ru blazed the headline, "Scared? Poroshenko refuses to debate Zelensky." And TVC, Russia's fourth largest state-run television station, wailed, "Poroshenko the European, frightened by a comedian." Ruskaya Vesna and others featured dismissive stories claiming Poroshenko was scared off by Zelensky's debate challenge. But that's not really how things went down. Poroshenko, in fact, is the one who initiated the discussion about presidential debates in the first place. After exit poll results were announced on election day on March 31, Poroshenko called on Zelensky to a debate. Quote, "A debate between the two leading candidates is a key element of the election. If a candidate evades debating, it means he has nothing to say," Poroshenko said. Russian fakes claiming Poroshenko was evading a debate with a comedian appeared after Zelensky released a video calling on President Poroshenko to debate him in the country's largest sports and soccer venue, the Olympic Stadium. Russian television channels enthusiastically replayed Zelensky's video with scores of talking heads gleefully speculating that Poroshenko would not take up the challenge. Poroshenko then responded to Zelensky in his own video posted on the president's official website. He reminded Zelensky that Ukraine's law on presidential elections says the debates have to be held in the Suspilne television studio, Ukraine's public broadcaster, and are financed by the state budget. Poroshenko suggested Zelensky read the law and reminded him that presidential debates are not a show. He ended his video by telling Zelensky, "I'll be waiting for you." Meanwhile, Olympic Stadium management says they have not received any official requests to hold presidential debates in the stadium. NATO is trying to exacerbate the situation in the Black Sea region with ships from the Netherlands, Turkey, Romania, and Bulgaria entering Georgian and Ukrainian ports, if you believe Russian media. Russian Duma Defense Committee Deputy Chairman Yuri Shvitkin declared such NATO sea maneuvers were escalating tensions in the Black Sea, and Russia had to respond accordingly. Others went even further, accusing NATO of intentionally provoking Russia. Konstantin Blokhin, an analyst from the Center for Security Studies at the Russian Academy of Sciences, said that NATO uses any country neighboring Russia to its advantage only to aggravate Russia. On April 5, NATO launched the large-scale naval exercises in the Black Sea together with Ukraine and Georgia. A few days earlier, NATO ships entered Ukrainian and Georgian ports, causing a storm of Russian indignation. Ukraine's Defense Minister Stepan Poltorak has repeatedly said such exercises are always planned well in advance, and neighboring countries are well aware of the exercises before they even begin. During exercises in March led by NATO, Georgian Defense Minister Levan Nazoria emphasized that, as a defense organization, NATO has no intention of intimidating other countries. Quote, "NATO's goals are purely defensive, and these exercises are not a threat to Russia," Nazoria said. Russia has an enduring fake narrative about NATO that they recycle repeatedly. It goes like this. The intention of Ukraine and Georgia to join NATO is a threat to Russian security. Therefore, any cooperation between these countries and the alliance is aimed at provoking Russia. A lot of people think this makes sense, but not really, and here's why. On April 4, NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg emphasized that Georgia and Ukraine are sovereign states, free to choose their own path and develop their own foreign policy. Stoltenberg said, quote,
"Just the idea that it is a provocation against Russia that Georgia aspires for membership or that Ukraine does the same is really, really dangerous. Because as soon as you accept that that's a provocation against Russia, then you accept that Russia has the right to decide what neighbors can do. And that is the same as to accept a world order where big powers can decide what neighbors can do or cannot do. And that is to re-establish the whole idea of spheres of influence."
And remember, it was Russia that invaded Georgia in 2008 and Russia that invaded Ukraine in 2014. And now a fun story from our colleagues at EU versus Disinfo about a Russian anchor putting her foot in her mouth. In the middle of a marathon of live streaming coverage of Ukraine's March 31 presidential elections, Russian state TV host Olga Skabeyeva told her co-host Yevgeny Popov, quote, "We're not on TV right now, we can tell the truth." A Freudian slip? A sincere confession? Maybe she thought the camera was off. Well, Skabeyeva's comment was quickly noted by Juliet Davis, an American expert in Russian disinformation who translates and analyzes Russian state TV in real time on Twitter. Skabeyeva reacted to Julia Davis's comment with a tweet simply saying liar and a blinking smiley. Her response is a combination of two classic disinformation techniques at the same time, flat denial and hiding behind the joke. Nevertheless, Davis had heard right. You can see for yourself. What's interesting is that Skabeyeva's comment echoed whistleblower testimony from Leonid Krivenkov, her former colleague on TV channel Russia 1. Earlier this year, Krivenkov told Radio Free Europe Radio Liberty that network employees would joke around by saying, "your turn to lie," on their internal communication system before switching over to a colleague. In another classic case, an employee of state-controlled NTV confessed on camera to having spread disinformation. The NTV journalist did not realize he was being recorded when he told a BBC correspondent that his network had reported the killing of a little girl in Ukraine, knowing that the killing had in fact never happened.
Не погибла? А как же так? Передали же.
Вынуждены были передать, потому что заявил.
We know that Russian state media prefers to ignore domestic affairs and broadcast almost obsessive coverage of events outside Russia, especially about Ukraine. Now we also know, thanks to Julia Davis's Twitter, that Kremlin's propagandists are paying attention to how their work is being monitored and exposed by others. That's it for this week. You can find much more dissected disinformation on the StopFake website. As always, be vigilant, look out for fakes, and if you spot any disinformation about Ukraine, forward it to us for a truth autopsy. I'm Marko Suprun, and this is StopFake. Thanks for watching.